Robots activate.
We'll jump around till you're in a house of pain. It's Ribbot!
Ribbot got started because we, throughout our college experience, built small robots to compete.
The 3-pound weight class, we think that this is the best weight class to get started in because the robots aren't that expensive yet.
Some of our team, specifically David, had really high aspirations to apply to BattleBots. And David was really a unifying member.
So my name is David, and I'm loosely affiliated with this team. I've once seen this team on TV, but I've never worked on it. that's an answer I've been giving people at competitions. They're like, oh my god, are you David? And I just say, oh, I'm loosely affiliated. Okay, so I really started with seeing BattleBots on that first reboot season and realizing that it actually was a potentially achievable goal. For us, we kind of all started as friends. We were all at school together, we took classes together, we worked on projects together, and then through those relationships, we developed into this team that we see today.
I took it as an opportunity to learn about motor controllers, you know, create my own designs that met my design goals.
When making the jump from the 30-pounders and less to the 250-pounders, there's just such a huge knowledge gap that we didn't have.
Our first BattleBots fight, we zip-tied everything. Motor leads, battery leads, pieces of foam. And after the fight, we opened the top plate of the robot, and there was a pile of broken zip ties.
And it's just tiny lessons like that. Fixing those, learning about those, can make your robot do that much better, even if the core design stays the same.
So we really want to separate the left and right side. And especially with the new rule change, you won't get counted out for crab walking. So now, more than ever, it's extremely important that you at least have one side of drive still functioning.
Ribbot kind of has a history of getting rules made about us. It's not that we're outside of the bounds of the rules, but we like to really play in that gray area. One of the big rules in our first season was the foam.
We used foam in order to create a really realistic looking frog. In between fights, it was messy.
So our rule was made to ban the use of external foam. And then the next season, we caused a whole bunch of delays because of our modularity, where other teams were refusing to get ready because they didn't know what kind of robot they would be competing against. So then a new rule was made on how teams had to lock in their configurations with production before the match. And the season after that, we came in with our super high voltage system. We were running 60S, and they agreed to make an exception for that year with the understanding that the rule would change at the end of the season.
You know, if you are doing something that motivates BattleBots to make a rule precluding it, then you're doing something right.
It just shows that we're trying things that are different, especially given how BattleBots is moving. A lot of people do things in a lot of the same ways. There are things that work, and people do things that work.
We definitely want to bring some new ideas. I'm in the sport to learn. There's no better way to learn than to design something from scratch.
It's a good feeling to know that we're trying things that are different enough that BattleBots is like, oh, we haven't thought about that before. Unfortunately, we don't like it, but now we have to put a rule in just for you.
We've opted for a completely custom solution for the motor controllers.
Going into season 7, we had a lot of high expectations for us, especially given our performance the year prior. So we were feeling really good. The fundamentals of the robot were really good, except for the fact that they made that new rule.
Now we are required to use a 16-cell LiPo maximum, and that required us to do a lot of redesign of our system.
We pretty much had to change everything, specifically around the weapon, determine a new motor configuration, switch architectures. We moved from an IGBT-based power inverter to a MOSFET-based inverter. I think the first thing we learned, isolating systems is critical, and some form of redundancy is critical. This is probably the beefiest power stage that we've made, so we kind of named it like Big Chungus. The MCAD co-designer tool was used to export a relatively simple board, but was critical in the MCAD space for wire management and retention of cables.
Those kind of optimizations just helped us make the robot better.
And it's very difficult on, especially the weapon system, to separate the battery pack.
It's really tough to test a heavyweight weapon. For a 250-pound robot, there's really only one place to test it safely, and that's in the test box or in the battle box at filming. We ended up catching on fire.
Almost all of the fires that we have are board related. They may start with the board and end up with the batteries, but they definitely almost always start with the boards. And it was a really cascading effect that lasted about 20 minutes. It's a really, really weird thing to grab a red hot ingot of lithium polymer battery with tongs while it's burning.
Not only was it extremely expensive, but we also successfully single-handedly shut down the testing area I'm filming and also smoke screened half of the pits. So that was like a very proud moment for us where we just disrupted everybody and everything.
We came to filming with two sets of batteries for the weapon system. That fire consumed one of our sets of weapon batteries. This did impact our competitive advantage going against Witch Doctor in our first fight.
When the season actually got going, we didn't get to really see what our weapon system could do for our first three matches. We sustained damage in one way or another that really didn't allow us to highlight the power of the weapon. And that was, I think, really disappointing to not have the validation of, even if it didn't work, just to not know whether or not all this work we put in was helping us win or lose even.
They need a big win, probably a KO, but can't close the book on them just yet.
I brought the team together before our Scorpios fight with the mentality of we very realistically could go 0-4 tomorrow. We needed to make some changes, we need to band together, we need to find what made our team good to start with and start pursuing that again.
David really rallied the troops and rallied us for one last push to make the playoffs. And we did. We were modifying our ground game configurations and constantly iterating to try to improve our performance.
It felt like from our test box incident and any other incidents before that, we were able to make some changes that prevented the failures we saw.
And that brought us to the highest high.
What the? Oh, God! Oh, and another! Oh, my God! This is gonna do it! It is a fundamental effort. That is the 2018 Ribbot. It's moving on to the round of 16.
So in 2020, we had this amazing run where we were able to get a top 8 finish, but what ultimately knocked us out was Black Dragon.
Black Dragon and Ribbot. Their first fight gave us one of the sport's greatest playoff moments, a back and forth brawl that saw the Brazilians survive and win a judge's decision after being on fire for more than 2 minutes.
They're widely renowned as a very durable robot.
Look out! Oh, Black Dragon's getting underneath Ribbot. Atlantic's a nice shot, but Ribbot coming right back. Black Dragon inverted. To get a good angle. Oh, another shot by Ribbot. Oh, and a follow-up. Black Dragon stunned by that shot. Oh, the countdown has started. Black Dragon still unable to move. Ribbot with its second straight upset to advance to the round of 8.
In season 6, we had the second seed going into the tournament. We had such a great seed to start. Our entire bracket was cut short with Hydra.
Our next fight in the playoffs was against Hydra.
We knew it was going to be a tough one.
I hope I have mentally prepared myself enough. I hope I have the mechanical experience to actually move the stick the way that I need to. Once the lights go green, it's full blackout.
40 seconds into this fight, we have a classic stalemate. You can feel the tension building. Both drivers jockeying for low ground, but nobody's been able to get the clear edge. Well, we're more than halfway through.
Whoa.
And there's a shot by David Jin. A driving air by Jake Ewer.
Whoa.
Here comes Ribbot now.
Uh-oh. Inward.
Ribbot now chewing on the side. Now taking Hydra for a spin. There comes the countdown. A precise Ribbot is going to end up moving on to the semifinals and avenge last season's playoff loss.
The opportunity to get revenge on robots that had previously knocked us out was kind of just luck that it happened to play out that way, but it was great to have that chance to prove that our robot is better than every iteration that we had brought prior.
So going into our final match,
I don't want to talk about this one.
I think if you asked the pool of builders at filming who was going to win, most would have bet on Sawblaze.
This is a rematch from 2019, and this was a big fight for us because in 2019, Sawblaze won pretty decisively. We wanted to win this fight, for sure.
It was not looking great for us, because if we won against Sawblaze, our next match would have been against Huge. So the two robots, the only two robots that we had no plan for going into the season, were our next potential two matchups. So yeah, we knew it wouldn't. The chance of it going well was pretty low going into that match.
Obviously, you know, we had a great run in the playoffs, and we were stopped by the same opponent that stopped us in 2019.
He's a world-class robot. Sawblaze was the champion, and there's a reason.
Obviously, ending the season on fire is never the way you want to go out. That being said, we had one heck of a comeback throughout the entire season. We started 0-3, we ended up top four. I don't think anybody could have predicted that. And also be able to bring a robot that was really down in the dumps back, a robot and a team actually, that was down in the dumps back and have such a great and successful season. We've made improvements. We are better than we were before. And that's always a great feeling.
It may not make you happy, but it's definitely gonna motivate you to make a difference. Maybe that's the way to phrase it.
But it just spurs us on to, you know, continue to develop and try to improve for the next season.
Feels really nice. I hope you could see it in the whole team.
The whole competition is iterative. You might have a really bad fight, and that stinks, but what's really important is that you learn from your past fights and past experiences, and you try to improve the robot moving forward so that you can be more competitive. We're looking to redesign a lot of aspects of the robot, a new motor controller using Altium Co-Designer. We're looking to design a new motor to power our powerful weapon system and our drivetrain.
The weapon system is becoming better, and there's more performance that we can get out of it. More optimization, and even more just simplification.
We need to very tightly integrate our ECAD and MCAD design to be able to make sure that we can fit all the components that we need on our controller, but we need to make sure that controller can fit within the physical constraints of the robot. Altium Co-Designer allows us to very easily generate our board in our selected CAD tool and be able to drop it into our solid model to be able to do a fit check. And we can do this very easily, which allows us to iterate faster. Clear enough for him to understand what happened.
That tool kind of blew me away. You know, this shouldn't actually be difficult, so much help. And as a designer, you can really iterate fast through designs.
This gives us the maximum flexibility to change things. Like the world is our oyster now. We can do whatever we need to fix the problems that we ran into in previous seasons.
BattleBots is the pinnacle of the combat robotics experience. So a lot of times you design a product and you're under a really tight time constraint. BattleBots allows you to iterate every season so you can continue to get better.
You don't have to follow what other people think is the correct way to succeed. There's a lot of different paths to get to that end goal.
The best way to learn is to actually do. And you hit hurdles, you hit roadblocks, failures, and those are the best opportunities that you can take. Sit down, analyze what went wrong, and become a better engineer because of it.
Thank you for watching Altium Stories. If you found this story inspiring, don't forget to hit the like button and share it with your friends and colleagues. By subscribing and hitting the bell icon, you'll never miss out on the latest engineering stories from our channel. We would love to hear your thoughts, so please comment and let us know your favorite engineering story. Thank you for supporting us and helping us continue to share the impactful work being done by engineers around the world.